on the Prime Minister for 5,000 people a year is derisory. Perhaps he'll double that, perhaps he'll treble that. Will we double or treble the numbers? I don't know. We should need to react to whatever opportunities, to whatever needs are available, and we ought to do it unitedly. The second thing I think he's absolutely right is that what happens in this city should be the decision of this council. Because we know the communities that people can be placed in, we know the housing people can be placed in, and I draw more long-standing members of the council's memory to the fact that in 2001-2002, 4,500 people, asylum seekers and refugees, were dumped in this city. And the first we knew about most of them was when they turned up at our one-stop shop. No coordination, and many of the communities they were dumped in would love to have helped them. If they'd known the languages, if they'd known they were coming, if they'd known the needs, if they'd known how to do it. But we didn't know because the contract was with a private sector provider who went for cheap terraced housing, and if you remember, two tower blocks in Everton and swamped the communities. That is wrong. What happens here will be best managed, most economically managed, most fairly managed, if it's this council doing it. But if I just touch briefly on the amendment which I am supporting, which I do think, with respect to the mayor, adds to this. I give two examples. I also give a doctor who's highly qualified, but whose English wasn't very good. He wasn't even allowed to go on to an English course, although he had a technical specialism that the city actually needed. Ridiculous. In Picton, I came across an asylum seeker who fled 2 days later from the Democratic Republic of the Congo, therefore a French speaker, whose English was perfect, who had been a permanent secretary. He totally reorganised St Hugh's Catholic Church, but he wasn't able to use his skills in this city even as a volunteer. Now, many of the people don't have the skills, the knowledge to work, but many of them do, and all of them should be trained to give them the opportunity. So whilst I agree very much with the mayor about the numbers game, I do agree with Councillor Rapsford about the dignity of work and the fact that many of these people are bringing skills and professions which will actually add to what this city needs. So I would ask the Labour Party to think again about this particular amendment.
Councillor Cushman.
None of us could have felt to have been moved by the pictures of people trying to get across the border in Hungary, and horrified when tripped up by TV camera woman, I should say, or that terrible picture of the child that's washed up on the beach in Turkey. And there have been some sort of comments that there have been tweets that the mayor's received, which have been totally and utterly vile and disgusting. There have been some letters in the Echo, sadly, yesterday, that I thought showed a total indifference to the inhumane experience that these people are going through, and even heard some on the radio on the Roger Phillips show that I found quite disturbing. I think the kind of indifference that's probably been whipped up by UKIP and the discussion about immigration has led us to a dark place for some people in that sense, and it made me reflect on my own family, and I mentioned this to my own colleagues here. They came here from the UK in 1914. Their daughter didn't survive the journey. They'd already lost two children in the Ukraine before they came. My granddad never saw any member of his family again when he came here, and left him with guilt till the day he died about that. His father died of hunger and famine in the 1930s. And the rest of the family perished either in the Civil War after the Revolution or when the Nazis were occupying between 1942 and 1945. And I often think what kind of conversation they had before they left. So, and how difficult that must have been. And for people to think that it's easy for people to make these moves and these changes, I think is completely wrong and totally, utterly misplaced. And I've had in contradiction to those vile tweets and some of those indifferent, terrible letters that have been in the papers. I've had people approaching me who have offered their house to children to come over here. I've had people who are offering their houses for people to come here, which is showing that, which I believe, the vast majority of people in the city are supportive, will be supportive of helping those people who need it to come here, like they helped my grandparents so many years ago. And I think, in addition to this motion, I think that it's beholden on this government, not, as Frank Boyle said, to set an offside rule in the refugee game, because there isn't one. People who are on the borders of Europe should also have the opportunity of seeking asylum in this country, and indeed even in this city. And as part of what we do, as I'm not sure we can change the law in terms of people working, but I think in terms of trying to mobilise the voluntary sector, and those people in this city, and they'll turn up on Saturday to prove it, who will provide the support for people, should have the opportunity to do so. And my final word is that and I said this in an email to the mayor, but my grandfather would have said, in response to what you said in allowing 100 families here when the call was for 10 for each of the authority, he would have said that was a blessing. He would have said, and you can add it to your Jewish and Yiddish lexicon, Joe, is it would have been a mitzvah, and I thank you for that.
Could I just advise the council that we normally have 20 minutes for these motions, and we've nearly reached that time. So with your support, can I say that we extend it for 5 minutes? But also, for the list of speakers that I've got now, could you really be brief so that we can try and keep to some sort of timetable? Okay? Councillor Cumming.
Thank you, Robert. Firstly, I want to congratulate you all for the speed with which you responded to this typical compassion play on behalf of yourself and of the city. I want to kind of put on record my embarrassment for the shame that this government, and in particular David Cameron, should feel for their lack of response, particularly as a father, when he often will bring up the concerns of his disabled son with regards to defending his cuts in the NHS. They could find no compassion for the flotsam of a small child floating out in waters, disgraceful. Not only did they show no compassion, but they don't give any extra money. They take money from an existing budget and redistribute it. That's sure what these people are like. I do have a couple of concerns, though. When it comes to Steve's amendment, I do believe this adds significantly to the resolution. If asylum seekers do come here, and we welcome them, and they're enabled to obtain leave to stay, and they're enabled to work, then it will be a relief on the public purse. There's no doubt about that. The concerns, rightful concerns Joe has in terms of our ability to be able to resource this, are ameliorated. So, give this serious consideration. Why would you not consider allowing these refugees to work with the dignity of work if it contributes to their well-being, to the cohesion within society, their integration, and for a reduction in the public pace? Seriously consider that. That's your to do so. I do have another concern, and that's around why, God forbid, given the numbers, and I researched this, the numbers of the people who have died trying to do this appalling journey, and many, many journeys, many and many of whom, sadly, are children, to our shame. I once read that when you have a child, you give consent to the agony of watching your heart walk around outside your body. And when you see figures, when we see what we've seen, you just want to stop the world and get off. But these are not just Syrian children. Well, my research shows that quite often, in a number of wars that we have in Yemen, where Saudi Arabia are happily bombing, probably with our weapons or with American weapons, we have them in Eritrea, we have them in Iraq, we have them in Afghanistan. Any one of these children, sadly, are even now floating, sadly, face down in seas in across our world. What has happened that this is just about Syrian children? Is it just because it's easier for David Cameron? So I can say this needs to be about asylum seekers.
Councillor Cummins, could you please sit down now? I did ask people to be brief. I mean, I know this is a really serious subject, and I've got at least another 4 or 5 speakers that wish to make a comment. So, there's a second amendment, Sandy, right of reply from the mayor. So I'd be really happy if you could really keep your comments brief, if you would.
I do that, so you shouldn't. just very quickly, just on something that Councillor Kemp said before about Everton being swamped. We weren't swamped with the two tower blocks with the mostly Iraqi actually asylum seeker that came in about 2000, I think it was 2001. What we needed though was we should have had some preparation. It goes back to Joe's mayor's issue about saying resources should come in to support the host communities. Those poor guys went on hunger strike, as we know, and 12 of them turned up to the church and asked for sanctuary. We looked after them, it was going to be for 3 days, it was for 6 weeks. But what was very interesting about that was that then the young people in the Refugee Youth Club got to know them, they got to know their names. We understood the system so we could challenge the government on the system as well. The issue was that it wasn't a managed process. But what was lovely out of that as well was not only relationships were built up, but we had, if you remember, we had Louise Elmans, our MP then, who was obviously Jewish. We had our GP, who was Jewish. Most of those guys were Muslims, and they came to a church for sanctuary. So we learnt a lot, and they learnt a lot. And I think that says something about Liverpool, where actually, as the mayor said before, we're a welcoming city. And let's not forget, that we had, I think it was 500,000 Irish refugees that came over in 2 years. Yeah. So it's how you put the figures from the government into perspective. And one of those is my grandfather.
What's the same country?
I have got Councillor Rasmussen. I mean, do you need to?
Do you know what? If it were to Gary, I wasn't going to speak. But I will. No, Lord Mayor, I really feel that I've got to say something on this one. My family came here from Ireland in the 50s. God love them. They made the mistake of moving to London. But after a few years, we ended up in Liverpool. Now, I remember what my mum and dad suffered being told to beg off back to the bogs. I remember being thrown down. What I thought at the time was a big hole when I was four. It was actually a freshly dug grave in Allerton Cemetery. You can laugh at stuff like that. But it didn't take the picture of the little boy to get me going. I was privileged to work with asylum seekers and refugees around 2000 with some of your boys in the towers. I remember, I'll call him Razor, he was an eye surgeon from Iran. All he wanted to do was get a job in the chicken factory with frozen chickens so that he could get his qualifications translated and work in England. I remember young Ali, he was an engineer in Iraq. All he wanted to do was work in the chicken factory so that he could get an English girlfriend, preferably Scouse. But the one I want to tell you about, people stick in your mind for different reasons. This young guy walked in one day with the biggest smile you've ever seen in your life. Beautiful looking lad. And he was from Rwanda, isn't it? We'll call him Moses. And Moses would come in every day. And it was at the time there was a loophole. And some asylum seekers were given right to work under certain conditions. He begged me to get a job. This lad used to walk in every day, Mary, Mary, anything, anything. And he had a little limp. And I was like, okay, I got him a job in the mushroom farm in Ormskirk. This lad was made up, set him up, got him a bus pass, showed him where to go the first day, off he goes the next morning, made up, he's got this job. I get a phone call from the employer a couple of hours later. Bear in mind, I used to pull every stroke that I could think of, bend every rule to get a lad or a girl into work to make them feel better. He said, what are you playing at? And I was like, what? He said, Mary, you've sent me a lad who won't work. And I went, who? He said, Moses. I went, no, you're wrong. He said, look, all I asked him to do was climb a ladder. I'm like, yeah, well, he won't do it. I've sent him home. I get told Moses gets him back in. And remember, we've got broken English going on. I didn't speak whatever the language is in Rwanda. But the next day he comes in, gives me an envelope and he says, Mary, please read it. Gary, you got upset before. I open the letter And it was from when he came in the country, the back of his legs were missing. The back of his neck where they tried to behead him was gone. So I phoned the employer up. I said, please, if I send him up now in a taxi, will you just read this piece of paper that he's got? He phones me back 2 hours later. Mary, he's working. I said, where have you got him? I've got him a grand job. No more ladders for that lad. These are the people that some people out in this country are talking about and moaning about. My honest hope in life is, I've got one boy, I've got two daughters. If any of them are in another country and they're in that position, that we would help them. Yeah. How Joe is suggesting we help these people now. But I've got to say, Steve, I love the idea of it's that being able to work, being able to contribute. That is so important, Joe, it really, really is. Thank you, sorry for the answer.
Councillor Hunt. Councillor, I'm going to be really unpopular with Mary now because I'm going to ask you to oppose Councillor Hunt's amendment. I totally support the motion. And, you know, when you listen to the moving testimony from Barry Pushman about his own family, you can't but be moved. I'm not opposing the amendment because I'm unsympathetic to the issues raised by Councillor Hunt. I simply want Council to oppose it because at this time it would overcomplicate the very difficult negotiations we're going to have with government. As Joe said, this is not going to be an easy process. Even now with the asylum seekers we take in the city, we have long discussions and negotiations with the Home Office about what support we're going to get. And I think that is going to be overcomplicated. It's going to be difficult enough as we take willingly those Syrian refugees in. And I think there's a time and place to talk about whether asylum seekers can work. And I think they should be able to work, but I don't think that time is now. And therefore, I'm asking Council to oppose the amendments.
Councillor Hunt.
Yeah, I would like to echo the words of Councillor Hunt just then. The current situation is that if a decision hasn't been made within 12 months, then an asylum seeker can seek permission to work from a select list of occupations of which the UK considers we have a shortage in. No one, I know for certain NGOs and others, but no one from churches and NGOs that I've seen have ever argued that the idea that any asylum seeker should be able to work because they see the inherent dangers of doing that and that it can increase bogus applications because it just essentially allows you a right to work in the country just simply because you turned up. It's very difficult. I think there is merit in investigating whether you reduce that time frame. Decisions are made to be made within 6 months for an asylum seeker. I think it's absolutely disgusting that people are kept waiting and waiting and waiting for a decision to be made on their case. I think there's merit in reducing that time period, but not to just willy-nilly allow people to work full stop. That may be difficult for some people to accept, but that's the world that we live in. And I fully echo the words of Councillor Hunt that in this very difficult situation that we're already dealing with a lot of acute problems in this city and with the current asylum process. And I'd like to think that we've done it very well. The Mayor has outlined just some of the excellent things that we already have done. That throwing in amongst all that, when we're trying to add extra help to these people and to the UK, it should be noted that an amendment like this just isn't actually helpful.
Mayor Anderson.
Okay, just speaking to the amendment and rejecting the amendment, and I'll tell you the reasons why. Laudable, Grace, absolutely willing to support it outside of this motion. More than happy to bring it back, or it was in a different motion. But as an amendment, it wrecks the motion. And I'll tell you why. Let me explain why, because you don't always have what we have, and neither do I. But let me explain to you why it will wreck. Because the law as it stands, the asylum law as it currently is, says quite clearly that if you seek an asylum and you haven't been granted that period to stay for 12 months or for 5 years, you cannot take up any work. If you get beyond a period of time, you can, and it's limited to who they say you will work with. Now, if we amend that motion, I guarantee you that that will be filibustered and lost in our discussions with the Home Office. They will simply reject it, because they will look for an opportunity to reject it, and simply say, we're not going to do that. The principle of what you say, I couldn't agree with you more. It's absolutely right. But let me also add a note of caution to this debate of around where we are with asylum. And, Councillor Cushman mentioned before about the letters and the vile comments that I've received and all of those things. Imagine what it is that we say in this motion. Not that we're about helping immediately the refugee crisis, but we then start adding to that by saying we want them to work and earn the rent and something like that. Imagine where that leads us to. It leads us to people then turning around saying, yeah, and they should work if they're here and should pay the rent. That's not where we want to get to. We want to get to asking the government to allow us to accommodate more asylum seekers in this country, provided they give us the support financially, the support logistically, and the ability to be able to go on and do it. Then, and after that, I'm prepared, happy to conduct a letter or to draft a letter that says exactly what you say, because I agree with it. But we've got to be so careful in how we approach it, because it will be rejected. And again, I would urge you all to support the main motion, not for political reasons, but to support the main reason, because it's urgent that we show a united front about what we do. And as always, Liverpool leads the way.
So, the voting is on the amendment. All those...
No, absolutely not, because I think this will actually take the whole issue about the refugees being
arrived. Said, Councillor Hanson.
I was asked
the question. We're going to the vote on the amendments. All those in favour? All those against? Any abstentions? For 8, against 63, no abstentions, the amendment's lost. Could I move to the second amendment, Councillor Crowe?
Lord Mayor, can I move
Is that seconded by the Lord
Mayor? I'll second it if I may move it.
Okay. The
seconder.
I'm the seconder, but it was submitted in Councillor Crowe's
name.
I'd like to second it, but I don't...
Who's going to move the motion and who's going to second it? Councillor Jennings is going to move the amendments and Councillor Crowe is going to second them. All right.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. Okay, first of all, we agree fundamentally with the aim of the Mayor's motion. But in presenting our amendment, I'd like to just start with a few statistics. And these are taken from the UN High Commissioner for Refugees report from June this year and the BBC today. So basically, the EU border agency said that more than 500,000 refugees arrived at the EU borders in the last 8 months. That's compared with 280,000 in the whole of 2014. The majority of which are from Syria in this current wave, and one of the problems is causing this crisis. In Syria, around 220,000 people have been killed, and 12.8 million people are in dire need of humanitarian assistance on account of the ongoing civil war and a rise in extremist groups. They are fleeing the persecution of being able to believe what they want to believe and the freedom of human rights that we so vehemently defend. The bulk of the Syrian refugees are being accommodated in the neighbouring countries of Lebanon, Turkey, Jordan, Iraq and Egypt. And that amounts to approximately 4 million people already. More than half of the world's refugees are children, as I said earlier. And shamefully, the UK doesn't even rank in the top 10 countries that has the most refugees, nor for accepting the most refugees for the size of our economy. And in June this year, just 0.23% of the UK's population was a refugee. So why are we not playing our part? Now, Theresa May has pledged to take 20,000 refugees in the next 5 years, and that amounts to approximately 400 people per month. Well, over the last week, there have been approximately 400 people per day at the borders of Hungary, Austria, Serbia, and thousands of Greece. As of noon today, there were 1,000 people in Vienna station alone, 1,000 refugees waiting to be transported elsewhere. Now, these figures are simply presented, put into perspective, really, the size of the problem, and the fact to emphasise the fact that we need to be doing so much more to accommodate these people. We have to remember also that refugees may be temporary. Many of them didn't want somebody to leave home. They're fleeing because they cannot simply live in safety there. They're missing their homelands, and they might only be in the UK for a short time. We have to remember that. So what we need is to help alleviate the immediate pressure, which is causing now violence and tensions that are becoming unsustainable in the wider European area. Ever-decreasing conditions for these people, as they flee from the violence from their homelands. So let's offer whatever shelter we can. Now, both the Mayor and Councillor Kemp said we need to get away from the numbers game. And that's what our amendment does. It avoids putting a cap at 100. We know there's government funding, but the number of people, for every asylum case, there is government funding for that, so we should be entitled to that. All our amendment does is gets away from capping it at a number that we could easily accommodate more. Liverpool has got a big part, and we're so proud that we will be meeting the Wales, and we are standing up for that. So,
Councillor Jennings.
Just to conclude, then, we want Liverpool to stand as a leader in this, and we should be the example for other cities to follow. So our amendment simply removes that cap and gets away from the numbers game that the Mayor and Councillor and Councillor Kemp have said they equally don't want to be involved.
Are there any other speakers? Come.
Thousands already, and we're adding more to that. So
I don't wish this to be a David Bowie song or a Green Party song. It's the Mayor's motion. It should be the Mayor's motion, no doubt.
Mayor Anderson.
Mayor, rejecting the amendments, and look, when we set out the figure of 100, it was the first city to respond, and we actually said it to try and move things on. It was pointed out that 10 refugees across the country, taken in by cities, by other authorities across the country, would provide 10,000. So I responded to that to say we take 100 and we could accommodate 100 within the city immediately to try to get people to respond and actually provide some agency to what was a desperate situation. Of course, since then, and since the motion was lodged, things have moved. The government has said 20,000, but I agree with you, we're near it. Exactly what Councillor Kemp said before, it's inadequate when you compare it with others. But what you have to do, is accept that negotiations and discussions need to take place. And again, if we put numbers on this, without getting them to agree that we get funded for this as well, we get that support and it's over a period, then it puts the city in a real difficult dilemma. What I understand has been so far said by the government is that they will provide spaces across the country for 20,000, and they will support for each refugee, whether that's a family or each individual, I haven't picked up the full details, it's £25,000. Just to give you an example of where, and £25,000 provides for accommodation and provides for all the health and all the things that people may need. If you, by the way, just incidentally, for your own figures, if you'd applied that to the numbers that we've got 1,800 in this city, that comes to £45 million that we've been deprived of in terms of the city, holistically, health, education, all of those things. So we're happy to do more. But, you've got to accept that we've been getting battered by people as well in the city who are saying, well, we've got to balance this right between taking the city with us and making sure that they feel like we feel that things got to be done. But it won't take away from their services. And the people in Kensington, the people in Everton, the people in parts of the city where they feel, rightly or wrongly, and I believe wrongly, threatened by refugees, we have to win them. This is a step approach. And if we again start talking about massive numbers or whatever, or figures and putting figures on it, we mentioned 100, but it has actually changed. I mentioned 100 at that time, and since the motion went in, the government have announced 20,000. So I'm not supporting the amendment. We support the motion. The motion gives us the a scope and the ability to be flexible and negotiate with government, which is what I intend to do. And the team of officers here, because we've got a great team, providing with me and the chief executive with the resources to be able to enter into those negotiations and get that real difference made. And I think the amendment complicates it and makes it more unlikely that we'll get at least a listening from government. And again, we've got, over this weekend, I've got an opportunity to talk to people about this, and we'll be presenting that case to you. So I can't support the amendments, but I know, and what I can say to you is that I fully support your views in terms of what to take more, and we will, if we can, provided we look after our city as well.
Councillor Jennings, if you...
Lord Mayor, as a minor amendment, would the Mayor be willing to accept a three-word amendment to his own, to the motion to say an additional 100 refugees seeking asylum as a starting point, and that gives us the flexibility to accept more?
I'm more than happy to accept that, because that's what I said. I said it in my contribution area, and I said it now. But what I can't do, and what I'm really unwilling to do, is stick a figure on it. And you're right, but what I can tell you that tomorrow, The bigots, the people that are nasty, whatever, they'll all be picking up on this and say, oh, it's an open check, it's an open, whatever, because as a starting point, well, how many are you going to say? How many are you going to say then? That's what happens tomorrow. So see it from my point of view. That's why I'm saying to you, it's about leadership, it's about doing it. But my end talking position is exactly the same as yours, to take as many in a humanitarian crisis as we can, providing we get that support.
Marilyn, I'd rather face the racist bullying than I would face another child drowning off the Lesbos.
Well, it looks like we haven't got an agreement there, so we're going to go to the amendments. All those in favour? All those against? Any abstentions? For the amendment 4, against 67, no abstentions, the amendment is lost. So we're moving to the main motion. And can I call Councillor Spurrell, who's patiently waited to make a contribution?
Thank you, Lord Mayor. So an American friend of mine posted on Facebook expressing his frustration at the lack of response from the US to the refugee crisis and how you've got it so right in Europe. And he posted a link to the video of the reception that the refugees got when they arrived in Germany. And I remember feeling guilty. Friends in America see Europe as his welcoming place, and yet here was the UK with such a long history of welcoming refugees, migrants, asylum seekers, and we were barely scratching the surface of the support we should be offering. All those people in Germany welcomed refugees with open arms, and what were we doing? Nothing. Another post I saw on Twitter was an article looking at the contents of the luggage the refugees had brought. What they had thought so important that they couldn't leave behind. For some, it was a phone and a charger, so they could keep in touch with their loved ones. For others, it was simply baby food and nappies to look after their son or daughter. And for others, it was just a spare change of clothes. And that was it. And it got me thinking, looking around my room, what would I choose to take if I was leaving my house for possibly the last time? I can never decide what to take on holiday, never mind what to put if it was potentially my last suitcase. Some of the refugees had to lose their bags while they were on the boat to ensure they didn't sink. Children's toys, photographs, clothes, medicines, all lost just to try and reach a new life. And it breaks my heart to think of what they've had to give up. And then there was that picture of the young boy on the beach. And suddenly my Facebook feed was full of people signing petitions urging David Cameron to get a grip and offer these poor people refuge. And eventually he relinquished. He's allowing 20,000 refugees to be settled here over the next 5 years, as we've already heard. But it's not enough. There is so much more we could and should be doing. And why did it take the picture of a dead boy to make him wake up and listen to what we were already saying? That we have a moral responsibility to recognise our role in helping people who are literally giving their lives to get here. And to all those people, and to all those papers calling them scroungers and freeloaders, don't you dare try and tell me that they're doing this because they want an easy life. Because there is nothing easy about what they have done. This was a life-changing decision to leave everything they knew behind in the search for a safer, secure life for them and their families. It gave me great pride to see the Mayor offer up our city as a sanctuary, and I sincerely hope other cities do the same, and the Prime Minister gives us the resources to be able to do that. And then next time my American friends praise Europe for their treatment of refugees, I won't have to feel so ashamed.
So the vote is on the substantive motion.
Can I ask for a point of information, clarification? The Lord Mayor said that he would agree to the insertion.
No. No.
Joe did.
No.
He did. I listened to it. That's the way I... Sorry.
Councillor Cummins' point, we just voted on the previous amendment for exactly that reason, that was not agreed.
Good job. Are you prepared now to add that as a start?
Councillor Cummins?
You're not.
All those in favour of the main. Thank you. Could we move on now to item 9, and can I invite Councillor Hetty to move the motion standing in her name?
Thank you.
Lord
Mayor, I'm sure that we're all aware that the council is creating an arm's length trading company called Liverpool Waste Management and Related Services, a LATCO, a local authority trading company, which will be wholly owned by the City Council and aims to cut the costs and improve services, including supporting residents in achieving a 55% recycling rate by 2020. Reaching our recycling target will deliver major savings for the people of Liverpool and be better for the residents of the city. We need a top quality service, a cost-effective service and an effectual service. We need one across the city, one that is flexible to our needs, one that will do what it should do when it should do it. This has not been a simple process, and the work of the Mayor, the Cabinet Member, Councillor Hanson and Council Officers, together with the unions and the workforce, is to be praised and thanked. All this has been done in a climate where Liverpool has had hundreds of millions of pounds of its funding brutally cut by central government. We cannot carry on in local government in the same way that we have been. It is absolutely imperative that we are innovative and creative in the ways that we deliver and procure services if we are really to provide the best value for people across the city. As our Mayor Jo Anderson has warned us on many occasions, the way that we are going, we will not even have funding to provide statutory services by 2017. That is absolutely terrifying. So it is right that we are finding new ways to deliver, new ways to be a council, and to be the best councillor we can be. I am proud of Liverpool City Council. We are not lying down and taking it. We are letting our residents not have substandard services, and we are not having unambitious plans for our future. We are fighting back, and we are working together to prove that we can create new types of working that are better than before and better for Liverpool. I hope, and I'm sure I'm not alone, that the council will continue with coming up with these new solutions to our problems, continuing improving services, continue to reduce costs, and continue to work in beneficial, collaborative ways with the workforce and with our unions. Thank you.
We have notice of an amendment by Councillor Crowe. Is this seconded?
Again, this is actually proposed by...
Could you please stand up, Councillor Crowe?
Sorry, Lord Mayor. This motion is actually proposed by Lawrence Brown and seconded by me.
Motion seconded, yes.
I've got Councillor Hanson, Councillor Hurley and Councillor Mitchell down to speak. Councillor Brown.
Thank you, Lord Mayor.
We are happy on this side to support the main objective of the motion presented today, which is to bring the refuse collection service back from private sector control to a new form of public service. However, what we want the council to do in addition to that is to make a firmer commitment to increasing recycling in future years than what is currently included in the motion. To avoid the worst excesses of climate change, we'll take radical changes to the way we live our lives. Ideally, our long-term future should have minimal waste. The aim should be to reduce our use of resources